I'm gonna just review real quickly. We're doing a series right now on grace, and I'm loving this series. I'm loving teaching on it. And I'm also loving every bit of, we're getting a lot of folks stirred up that are excited about grace. I love it when people get excited about the grace of God. We have some other people that are getting stirred up that don't like it, and I love that even more. So anyway, last week, here are some things that we said, because I think it's vital. We talked about, you know, do you feel like you have something hanging over your head? And we said this, that now that you're in Christ, we said there is no condemnation in Christ. And here's what we said. Condemnation comes from the devil, of course. Conviction comes from God. And we said conviction drives you towards God. Condemnation drives you away from God. And if you were not here, it'd be one that you can go back and listen to. You can grab it in our bookstore, or you can go online and just watch it online. But we encourage you to do that just because we think it's that vital. For all of you that are new, this is first time this weekend in this series, you've not been part of it. Up on the screen is the definition of grace if you want to look at it. The grace of God is unearned, unmerited, undeserved favor towards you simply because of Jesus' finished work at the cross. We say it this way, grace gives you God's supernatural ability to be able to do things that you would not normally be able to do. We say this, grace empowers you. So a lot of people teach on grace, and the idea people get that are sitting out in the congregation is, I can do whatever I want, live any way that I want, and grace is there so that God's just so nice to me. He doesn't care that I live. And that's absolutely not the truth. The truth of the matter is, grace empowers you to live the way God wants you to live. Grace is an empowerment so that we can live like Jesus. And so this weekend, before we get into what we're going to talk about and look at what we're going to talk about, I have a question I want to start off with. I need your participation. How many of you have ever flown before? If you've ever flown before, just raise your hand. So almost, it looks like almost everyone in the place, most of us have flown. Well, back in January, I was coming home from Fort Worth, Texas, from a conference that I was at. So I flew into Dallas, Fort Worth Airport, was flying back home, and I was flying into Cleveland. Pretty big plane. You know, it's one of the bigger ones, not those little ones that you're like, oh, Jesus, this is not the fun plane to be on. So it was a pretty big plane. And we were taxiing, you know, so we're going out, getting ready to take off. And here's what the pilot says. Folks, you're in for a bumpy ride today. I'm like, can we get off now? Like, I don't like flying on planes when it's like that bumpy, bumpy ride. He said, but it's not going to be a normal bumpy ride. It's going to be bad, and it's going to be the whole way. I was like, yes. That's awesome. So I always have my iPad with me, and I work on planes, especially if they have Wi-Fi. I just get on and start doing everything on the plane. So it just gives me another couple hours to work, you know? So I just thought, I'll just ignore everything. And so I got on. So we get to 10,000. That's when that bell rings and you know you can go on Wi-Fi. You know, that little ring thing that goes off. All the flight attendants get up and they start serving. He said all to the flight attendants at 10,000 feet, he said, do not get up. He said, we're about to go into turbulence. I was like, oh, Jesus. And the plane start rattling from the time we got to 10,000 feet. It did not. It's one of those things where you're like, I hope this plane has been upgraded, taken care of. Everything's been tightened because it was that bad. All the way until I heard these words, the flight attendant never got up ever. They sat the whole time. They looked nervous. And when they look nervous, it's not fun. I heard these words. We're about to go into our initial approach into Cleveland. I think the whole plane had a sigh of relief. I think people that never said thank you, Jesus, wanted to raise their hand and say thank you, Jesus. I mean, it was like that. And then I heard these words just a few minutes later, you know, 15, whatever it is, 20 minutes later. We're on our final approach. I mean, I wanted to stand up and just preach right then. I wanted to just say, now, there were several people that I knew on the plane. You know how when people get on and they're like, hey, well, I get that all the time. And this is what they said to me. I'm glad you're on the plane because we know it won't crash. That's what they said. I was like, awesome. So final approach, man, and those wheels hit the ground. And I could never tell you how happy I was that I heard the word final approach and we hit that ground in a good way. We were on the ground. I was like, yes. I don't know how many here tonight feel like you're going through some of the worst turbulence in your life. But what I want to talk to you from this subject of grace tonight is called the approach. And if you're taking notes, you can write it down. If you have a card, it should have been on the front of it. The approach. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, this is going to be about tonight approaching what God calls, what his word calls, what the Apostle Paul called the throne of grace. Now listen closely. If you're here and you say, I don't know what that is, you're gonna find out about it tonight. If you're here and you say, I've never made an approach to the throne of grace, you're gonna find out how to do that tonight. And if you're here and you're like, I don't even know what you're talking about, this is the best night to be in church, because if you are here and listen closely, you think you can get answers somewhere else, listen closely. There is not one answer that you're looking for in your life that you currently have that you're gonna find the answer separated from the throne. So if you think you can find it somewhere else, you've been going to people to find it, that's probably not worked out well, because people don't have your answer. Isn't it really crazy when people come to us and they're like, you gotta pray for me, you gotta tell me what the answer is, and it's like, listen, I'm trying to get answers myself, and you want me to get answers for you? And here's the deal about it. God designed it that every answer you need is found at the throne of grace. It just needs to get you. You need to get to the throne of grace. If you can get there, everything's gonna be okay. In James, I'm sure you're familiar with it, but I wanna read this to you, and we'll go to the scripture that actually is about this, but I wanna start here. James chapter 4, verse 8 says this, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. This is dealing about approaching God. Now listen, I've had people tell me before about people. They're so unapproachable. Has anyone ever said that to you before? They're so unapproachable. That's not the way God is. God is not unapproachable. He made a very clear path and a clear way. He says this, he says, draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. That's dealing with approach. Literally in the original translation, it says this, draw close to God, he'll draw close to you. Come close to God, he'll come close to you. So I started thinking about this, and of course the scripture that this is all based on this weekend is not found in the Old Testament, it's found in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, they had thrones. Hebrews was written by the Apostle Paul. He's writing to Jews who were literally under the rule of Greek rulers at the time, and there were thrones. You could go to a throne, but listen closely, only certain people could go, and if you didn't approach the throne a certain way, you literally could have some bad things happen to you. You could be beheaded for approaching the throne on the wrong way, a natural throne that they were going to. This is no lie. So if you're gonna go to this throne and you're gonna approach it, and they're thinking in their minds, so the Apostle Paul's writing to Jews that have been saved that understand this concept, and he's writing to them and he said, I want you to come to this throne. Think about the first thing that comes to their mind. I'm gonna get to go to this throne. Oh, that's right. Every throne I've ever approached here on earth, I had to approach it a certain way, and not everyone's invited to approach it. And if I do approach it the wrong way, I'm gonna get some bad stuff happening. So watch what the Apostle Paul does. Hebrews chapter 4, with that in mind, verse 16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Now listen closely. If there's a throne of grace, there has to be a king on the grace, or on the throne, right? On the throne, there has to be a king. If it's called a throne, there has to be a king. Listen closely. If it's a throne of grace, then the king who sits on the throne has to be a king of grace. I'll say it again because some of you got distracted. If you are going to a throne called the throne of grace, there has to be a king on it. The king who sits on the throne of grace has to be a king of grace, or he would never tell you to approach the throne of grace. Yeah, come on. Listen, this is so vital. So I think it's interesting because we all know that kings sit on thrones, and we know, you know, he's telling us you need to approach this throne of grace. So here's what I have found. People have distorted ideas about God, and this is why they have a distorted idea when they go to this throne, or some don't go because they have a distorted idea. So I think you know this by now. If you've been in our church, if you're new yet, you don't know this. And if you're here and you're like, I don't even know God and I'm in your church this week and I have no idea what you're talking about, just hang on, because what you're going to see tonight will paint a picture of the kind of God all of us who do follow him. You know, if you're here and you're like, I don't follow him, this is the kind of God we serve. But they have distorted views. I want to ask you a question. Where do you think distorted views come from? I want you to hear this. I'm trying to paint a picture for you to get this. Distorted views come two ways to people that say they're Christ followers. They come by you having a wrong view. And the reason why you have a wrong view is you're reading just the Old Testament and think God's still the same way. It gives you a distorted view. I have to look at the Old Testament through the eyes of the New Testament, through the eyes of Jesus bearing all the punishment, so I don't have to. So he's not doing what he did under the old covenant. We have a new covenant. But the other way distorted views come is distorted preaching. So if you sit under distorted preaching, it goes like this. The preacher seems mad, and he sure is painting a picture that God is mad. I'm never going to approach a God who's actually that mad. So let me give you just a couple things real quick. Y'all with me? Trust me, we're going to have fun tonight. So I grew up in parochial schools, Catholic schools. Most of you know it. I'm not against Catholics. I love them with all my heart. But I was in the principal's office. Now I know you think it's funny and you think I make these stories up. I wish my dad could be here to confirm all this to you. By the time I reached ninth grade in Catholic schools, I was kicked out. Ninth grade, 100 plus detentions in 1 year. Yeah, that's what my dad said. So starting in first grade, I started to go. I went to a public thing, you know, school for kindergarten. Then first grade, parochial schools, Catholic schools, St. James, Warren, Ohio. And they started to see me in that office so often that they thought something was wrong with me. When I went there, Sister Mary Edwarden was her name. She said, put your hand on the desk. I'd say, okay. I'm just a kid, little kid. Whack, she'd whack it. I mean, as a kid, it hurt really bad, right? And I got worse. It didn't make me better. I don't know why. Because that's second grade, third grade, fourth grade. In fourth grade, my teacher, Mrs. Kipper, that was her name, she became missing. She wasn't there anymore halfway through the year. My principal, while I was down at the office, said, you know why Mrs. Kipper's not here? You are the reason she's not here. I was like, yes. Glad I kept her home. Just kidding. So here's the deal. I'm just teasing. So here's the deal. Some people think they're going to the throne of grace. And God's not as bad as some of the preachers make him, but he is going to get you a little bit. You go there, he's going to get you. But other people, they have a whole different distorted idea. They think, this is serious. They think when you go to the throne of grace, I'm not hitting my hand with this. Some of you are looking at me like, what's he going to do with this? Don't fret. But they think when they go to the throne of grace, God has a hammer. And God's going to hammer them. Why would you go to a throne of grace and think, I'm going to go there, but God's going to hammer me while I'm there? I'm not going. Why would I go there? Why would you go there? So what people do is when you hear a preacher who's got a hammer in his hand the whole time, because that's what he does through the whole service, is he hammers you. And there are some people that they've asked me, they're like, Pastor, could you please hammer us a little harder? But see, here's what Romans 2:4 says. It says the grace of God or the goodness of God, it leads people to change. The goodness of God leads people to repentance. It's not a hammer. Now, you might be reading the Old Testament and think God had a hammer. But we're not living under the Old Testament anymore. We're living under the new, not under the old. Jesus took the hammer so you don't have to have the hammer in your life. So when you go to the throne of grace, you're not getting this when you go. So what are you getting? Well, let's just read a couple things real quickly. Y'all ready with me? He says throne of grace, right? So here's what translators have translated this into. It's the throne of dispersed love gifts is the way it reads in the original language. The throne of dispersed love gifts. Well, that doesn't sound like a hammer. It doesn't even sound like a ruler. It sounds like when you go there, he's going to do something good for you. He's going to give you something that is good, not bad. So watch this. He says, you're gonna go to this throne, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to the throne of grace, and I want you to come there boldly. Everyone say boldly. The word boldly literally means to be confident or to be outspoken, or listen to this, to be frank. So when you would go to a throne, this is written to Hebrews that understood the whole concept of thrones. When you would go to a throne back then, you only said what they told you you could say. You know, you don't go being bold, you don't go being confident, and you don't go being outspoken and frank. And God says, I want you to come to the throne of grace. He uses this specific word. I want you to be frank when you come there. I want you to be bold when you come there. I want you to just go ahead and be frank about whatever it is you want to say to God. Really? That's what he says. So it's really interesting. I don't know if you understand this. The next word he says, so that you might obtain. If you're taking notes, I want you to just jot this down, because I think it's interesting. This word obtain, and they might have already popped it on the screen, but the word obtain means to receive or to take. So here's what's crazy about this word, because most people that have been in church, you'll know this immediately. You know over there in Mark chapter 11, verse 24, where it says, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you'll have them. The word receive and the word obtain are the same Greek words. So here's what he's saying. When you come to the throne of grace, you can expect to receive something. See, some people think, when I go to the throne, I'm gonna receive this, or I'm gonna receive this. I don't know which one God's in the mood for today, so it might not be too bad or it might be really bad, but I'm gonna get one of those. And this is what God says. When you come to the throne of grace, you're gonna get something. You're gonna obtain something. You're gonna receive something when you come to the throne of grace. You are gonna go there and you are gonna get something. So I love this about God. I love that his word is so clear that he's gonna tell you, I want you to go to the throne of grace. I want you to know that you're gonna get something at the throne of grace. And oh, by the way, let me tell you what you can get. So he doesn't leave us hanging where we're like, I don't know what I'll get when I get there, but he leaves us in this instead. Let me tell you what you can get. So let's read. He says this. He says, when you come, you're gonna receive mercy. And if you're taking notes, mercy, in case you don't know, is God not giving us what we deserve. You know, like judgment, punishment. God's not gonna do that. So he said, listen, when you come to the throne of grace, you're gonna get mercy. So everyone look up here just for a moment. I want you to hear this. You don't need mercy unless you did something wrong. You don't need mercy. I don't need mercy if I've been living right for God. I need mercy when I've done something wrong and I'm gonna go there. And he says, you wanna get something when you go to the throne of grace? How about some mercy? You say, what's mercy? It's God not giving you what you really should get for what you really did. He said, I'm gonna give you mercy. So what kind of throne is this? This is a throne of grace, not judgment. A throne of grace, not you getting up there and God hammering you. It's a throne of grace. What else did he say? He said, well, when you come to the throne of grace, he said, you're gonna get mercy. Then the second thing he says is, it'd be obvious, right? You're gonna get grace. Grace is God not giving us what we do, is God giving us what we do not deserve, right? We don't deserve this, but God gives it to us anyway. And it's extended kindness. And so I like this. We go to the throne of grace, and grace is empowerment. So let's say you're here and you're like, God asked you to do something and you don't think you can do it. You know what you have to do? You have to go to the throne of grace and say, God, I'm gonna need your help. Anyone remember the story of Moses? God told Moses, Moses, you're gonna do this. And Moses said, I can't do that. God said, no, you're gonna do this. And Moses said, don't you know? I can't even talk properly. I have a problem talking. That's how Moses talked. I'm not trying to make fun. That's how he talked. And God said, I don't care about your speech. If I told you to do something, I'm gonna empower you to do it. So if you're here and you think, I can't do what God's asking me to do, you can't get anywhere else except the throne of grace to get the empowerment you need to do what God is asking you to do that you think you can't do. Come on. Some of you are sitting here like, well, you know, I don't know. I don't really know if I need to go there. Oh, no, you need to be there like every single day. Not once a month. Some people are like, well, I went there. You know, I went to the throne of grace. I can remember it was 3 years ago. Really? Like you need to be there every single day. God, I'm going to work today. I need your help at work. I work with people that sometimes they drive me batties and I'm gonna need your help. You need to go to the throne of grace. Get help before you ever go. Then watch what he says. And he says help, and I'm not gonna look at it now. I'm gonna come to help later in a moment. But then he says in a time of need. So if you look this up, it means your specific current situation. You know, need or situation. In other words, what you are currently facing in life, you're gonna need to go to the throne of grace. Listen, we don't always know everything, right? And so all of a sudden our kids start doing stuff that we're like, really? Listen, going to people and telling them what your kid did won't help you. I get it, we can talk to people, but if you really want that situation to change, you're gonna have to do something else. You're gonna have to get to the throne of grace and say, God, something's going on with my kid. I don't know exactly how to handle this, but I need you to help me here. Throne of grace. All right, y'all with me? So here's the problem with people, and I think this needs to be said. If you think God won't do anything for you and that God stopped answering prayer when the last apostle died, then you're never gonna go here. Because God's not in the business of helping people anymore. It's what it is. That's your lot in life. God wants you to suffer. I wanna say something just real quickly. Y'all with me, right? I wanna challenge you about something. The suffering the New Testament talks about is suffering for the gospel, not suffering in other ways that people have made this look. The only suffering the New Testament teaches on, 1 Peter, 2 Peter talks about suffering, is suffering for the gospel. And suffering because people persecute you over the gospel. Not suffering with sickness because God wants to make you sick. Not suffering with all these bad things happening because God's trying to teach you a lesson. That's not in the Bible. But if you have some good distorted preaching, you can go ahead and think that for the rest of your life. That's not the kind of God we serve. In fact, Matthew chapter 7, verse 11, Jesus made a statement. Matthew 7, 11, you can just write it down. It says this, if you then being evil, the better translation means natural, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to them that ask? When I go to the throne of grace, God wants to give me good things, not bad things, not hold things back. He wants to be a blessing to me. He doesn't want to take things away from me. So with all of that in mind, Ephesians chapter 2 is really interesting. I want you to write this down. I'm just going to read it real quickly. But if I'm going to go to the throne of grace, I have to be confident knowing that as a Christ follower, he's actually given me permission to do it and given me access to do it. So check the wording out, Ephesians 2, 17 and 18, Amplified Bible. And he said this, he said, and we came and preached, Paul's talking, the glad tidings of peace to you who were afar off. That's the people that were far off were Gentiles, and those who were near, those were the Jews. He said, for it is through him that we both, whether we were far off or near, now have introduction or access by one Holy Spirit to the Father so that we are able to approach him. I now can approach God. Why? Because Jesus gave me access. And nothing you do can keep you away from being able to go to the throne of grace. In fact, here's the deal. If God saved you and you've screwed up since then, he's also made a path for you to get back, or we serve a weird God. Sorry, I knew you were gonna screw up, but you can't get back now. And this is the kind of things that people preach all the time, and it's like, guys, no, we can get there even if we've screwed up. I'm glad about that. I don't know about you. So I want you to write a couple things down if you're taking notes. Very vital points that I want to make. First of all, you have a right to be at the throne of grace. You have a right to be at the throne of grace. You have not done something that God will say, no, you can't come here. Pastor was talking about other people, probably half the people in the building were the ones he's talking to. The rest of us were not able to go. No, everybody has a right to be at the throne of grace. If you are not a Christ follower and you're here just sitting in church, you have a right to the throne of grace. Your right will be the first step of you accepting Christ in your life. That's your first time to get to the throne of grace. After that, everybody, every single day, multiple times, can get to the throne of grace. Another thing I want you to write down, you can find help for your missteps, for our missteps at the throne of grace. You can find help there. I don't know about you, there's times I need help. I know you might think, no, Pastor, he's perfect. There's nothing about him that, no, I need to go there sometimes because I have missteps just like you have missteps. Everybody has them. We need to get the throne of grace. But here's what I love about the throne of grace, and I want you to jot this down. We can bring others to the throne of grace. So you know how many times people come to me and say, Pastor, I just need you to pray about this. You know what I do? I take them to the throne of grace. I wanna make sure they understand, I'm not gonna just say I'll pray for you. I'm gonna take you to the throne of grace right now and we're gonna get help for you right now. Why am I gonna wait? Why am I gonna do this? I'll be praying for you. Now, some people, they'll do that. They'll be like, hey, Pastor, pray for me. And they wanna get away. They're like, please don't take me there. Because they don't know what they're gonna get there, right? So they're like, don't you take me there either. I just want you to be praying. Pastor, be praying for me. Well, what do you want me to pray for? Just be praying. No, I'm gonna pray with you right now. We're gonna go to the throne of grace right now. I'm gonna take you there right now. Right? Why would you wait? So listen closely. If I can go to the throne of grace, here's what I'm trying to get across to you. Why can't you go? And in your prayer life, why can't you bring your kids to the throne of grace? My kids are giving me trouble right now. Take them to the throne of grace. Let me just tell you, taking them anywhere else, taking them to your friends and taking them to your neighbors and telling your neighbors how crazy they are is not gonna help them. Come on, taking your husband to your girlfriends and telling my husband, you wouldn't believe what he's doing. He is the jerk of all jerks. That's not the throne of grace. Are y'all with me? You think, well, my husband just doesn't want to change. No, your husband can't change. You want to know why? Because you keep on binding him up with the words that you're speaking at the wrong throne. And if you keep talking about him that negatively, she'll become exactly what you're saying. But if you take him to the throne of grace, things could change. Everyone say, thank you, Pastor. You're welcome. Anyway, I want to go back to Hebrews chapter 4. I'm almost done. Hebrews chapter 4. Here's the deal. My job here as a pastor, if I do anything, and anything ever is going to be successful, it's to get the people of this church to get to the throne of grace on their own. So let me show you how Paul really wrote this, and I believe this translation does such a great job of Hebrews chapter 4. This is the Message Bible, and I get it. Some people are like, that's not a translation. It's actually not really that great. But it actually is written by a guy who's a scholar. He's not like an idiot. He wrote it in terms that we all understand now. So listen to what he says, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 through 16. He says, now that we know we have Jesus, the great high priest, with ready access to God. Everyone say ready access. Jesus gives us ready access. That means at 4 a.m. you can get to him. I've been woken up at 5 a.m, 4 a.m. by him for me to come to the throne of grace for some of you. Thank you for waking me up at 4 a.m. because you're out there playing around and doing stuff you shouldn't. And God's got me going to the throne of grace for you. And I've done it. I've gone there. Listen to what he says, ready access. Let's not let it slip through our fingers. We don't have a priest who is out of touch with our reality. He's been through weakness and testing, experienced it all but the sin. So let's walk right up to him and get what he is so ready to give. Take the mercy, accept the help. Now, let's talk about this last thing that I told you I would talk about. He said, when you come to the throne of grace, you're gonna get some help. And if you study it out, the word help literally means, it's weird, I know it, but you'll understand it as we go on. Some of you have heard me say it before. The word help means a rope or assistance or aid given in a time of distress. A rope is really weird. It's like a weird thing to say. Until I started studying it out and I realized what he was saying. What he's saying is that there are times you need to be pulled out of the situation you are currently going in. So I love this picture, right? God throws me a what? He throws me a rope. Now, if you're here and you're like, I've never heard this before. I wonder if pastor's telling the truth. Listen, I don't get up here to lie to you. Right? This is not my goal, to come to church and say, hey, what I want to do today is make you think God is something he's not. So listen to what this says. In the Greek language, the picture that is painted about Hebrews chapter 4, that God will help you. He's going to help you. Everyone say help. The picture I want you to leave with is not just aid or assistance. That's great. In a time of distress, let me ask you this question. Without you raising your hand, how many here could raise their hand tonight? We all could do it, right? And say, I'm currently going through a time of distress. We live in distressing times. The scripture says it. This isn't, unless you're living in a cave and you never come out, this is a distressing time. Reading the news, listening to the news, it's distressing. I just stop. I'm like, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear your opinions anymore. My brain can't take it anymore. We live in distressing times. But check this out. Because we live in the society we live in, the culture we live in, right now, your children, my grandchildren, they have access to things we never had access to. Right? It's distressing. It's distressing on me to think that my children and my grandchildren have access to stuff that no one ever had access to. When we were growing up, back in the 70s, the first video game came out. Y'all remember this? It was the most unbelievably, when you look back at it now, dorky thing that ever, and if you saw it now, you'd be like, really? That's what you guys played? Yeah. Not Nintendo, guys. I'm a little older than that. I'm talking about the first thing that ever came out. It was like, oh my gosh. It didn't give us access to the internet. It didn't give us access to movies. Oh, along with this, you can access the internet. Any movie you want. We had three stations. I lived in Warren, Ohio. Channel 21, Channel 27, and Channel 33. If you had the right antenna, you could get Channel 43 out of Cleveland. And you were rocking if you could do that because you had four stations. They all went off after a certain time at nighttime. And there was this thing on your TV. Now, I have several hundred stations. So do you. I don't even need my stations. I can have no stations and just have Netflix. I don't need anything else. And so I'm closing. Listen, we live in a society that has all this stuff, and what it's done is caused more problems than ever. God hasn't changed. He's still the same. He's still saying this. Hey, you want me to pull you out of this, or you want to stay there? Because I got a rope. I can pull you out if you'd like to be pulled out. But you can just stay there if you want. You want to stay just doing nothing? You know how people are today, right? I mean, it's like, well, I've been watching Netflix for 8 hours straight. I caught up on everything. I'm not getting down on it, but you know how people are. I caught up on all my shows. 8 hours later, your brain's fried. And you're like, I'm not even sure there is a God. And here's God. Hey, you want me to pull you out? Oh, you're not ready yet? Yeah, go for eight more hours. By then, you'll probably be ready. And I could pull you out of whatever it is you're going through. Right? We have our kids going to schools and having schools pump stuff into them now that, man, when I was a kid, that never happened. I went to a Catholic school. You know what we learned? We learned about Jesus. Yeah, they actually prayed before every class. They actually had to stand up and salute, you know, to the flag. And we quoted it every single day. They would do it over the loudspeaker. We actually prayed every day over the loudspeaker, all of us together. You know what they do now? None of that. So our kids get to go to school. They get to learn all the stuff they're learning in school against God. They get to come home and turn on the TV and watch every show you could imagine if you allow them. Anything on the internet if you allow them. They're on Facebook. They're on everything else. You know what I'm talking about if you are a parent or a grandparent. Most kids today can use a phone better than their grandparents. I'm not saying it to make fun. My kids are better than my grandkids. They're like, give me that. I'll show you how to do it. I'm trying to Snapchat, you know, and my grandson's like, Papa, are you seriously? When were you born that you don't know how to Snapchat? I don't know how to do it. So here's what I want to say in closing. Those are all fun, and it is funny, right? But here's what's not funny. We have a culture of people and a generation of people that have gotten further away from God than ever. And we even have them coming to church. They're in church, but they're sort of far from God, even though they're in church. And the reason why they're far from God is God's standing there and saying, hey, I'll pull you out of whatever you're going through. Would you like some help? And most people are there saying, I don't know how to get help. I don't know what to do. He's like, it's right here. I'll help you. Just grab onto this rope and I'll pull you out of what you are going through. But the only way that can happen is if you get to the throne of grace. And the only way to get to the throne of grace is understanding you have to get there. I can't do this for you only. You have to go to the throne of grace. You have to go to God and say, God, I'm in trouble. God, I've got some problems. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 11, where we read a moment ago, he said, if you then being evil or natural know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask? Well, the verses above that, starting in verse 7, he says, ask and you will receive. He says this, knock and it shall be opened to you. He says this, right? He says, seek and you will find. You have to do something. When's the last time you went knocking on heaven's door? Come on, all you 70s people, you know what I'm talking about. When's the last time you knocked on heaven's door, right? Come on, listen. If you're out there and you're like, man, I haven't really knocked lately, that's what he wants from you. We're not trying to knock to find, and is he behind this door or that door? We're knocking to go to heaven and say, God, I need some help. I need a rope. I need you to pull me out of whatever I'm going through. I need your help in my life. You have to do that. And if you learned anything in church this weekend, here's what I want you to know. That if you go and you need help, he's not there with the sledgehammer. He's not there with a hammer. He's not there with a ruler. He's there to love you. Listen what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean there aren't times that God wants to correct us. I've had times where God's corrected me, but let me just tell you how God corrects. God corrects you in a gentle way, not a harsh way. God's not your preacher. God's not the preacher of the church you came out of. Man, I remember, he just used to preach us right into hell. Well, listen, Jesus wants to preach you right out of hell. He doesn't want to leave you there. He doesn't want you to be preached into hell. He wants to bring you out of. So if you walk out of church and you've learned anything, it's okay. You're going to make some missteps, but where you need to go is the most important thing. You needed to go to the throne of grace. Could you imagine this? What if we taught our grandkids, what if we taught our kids, instead of being on that all the time, instead of being on your phone and on your iPad, I want to show you how to get to the throne of grace for a moment. You know when we do it? We do it before they go to bed, right? Before you go to bed, let's say grace. Dear God, please let mommy open up more games on my iPad so that I can play more. Like, listen, we need to teach our kids. The iPad's not as important as God. The phone is not as important as God. Instagram's not as important as God. Twitter's not as important as God. Facebook, especially, that demonic thing called Facebook, is not as important as God. Right? What's important is this, that you understand, if I get to the throne of grace, I get help every single time. Let's close our eyes. I hope this helped you tonight. I believe it did. Let's just close our eyes just for a moment. Father, we come to your throne of grace tonight. I lift up this whole church. I lift up all these people in a seat tonight, all those watching us at our prison campuses. I lift every single one of them up to the throne of grace. I pray for them that you will help them in their time of need. You will give them mercy. You will give them grace. You will give them help as they are struggling in areas of their life. I pray for each person right here, right now, that whatever they need from God is going to be granted and given unto them, because you promised if we ask, we will receive. I pray for every person tonight, before we walk out of this building, they'll come into a relationship with Jesus that they've never had before. And Father, I pray you touch hearts right now in Jesus' name.